If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison-shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Well, good morning again. It's good to see you. Hey, I'm excited to introduce someone to you today. We as a staff have been praying for a new youth pastor, a student ministry pastor to come our way. And in addition to the prayers, I've been applying a little pressure to a man that I respect immensely, a man that is no stranger to the valley here. For 15 years, Stu Bigler worked with Youth for Christ. For 6 years, he was my high school pastor at Table Rock Fellowship. We have a long history together, and I know Stu's love for the Lord and his love for this community and his love for especially young people. He has a passion for discipling young people, a passion for seeing people get involved in the kingdom and coming to know Christ in a personal way. And so I'm excited to introduce to you today our new student ministry pastor, our new youth pastor, Stu Bigler, and excited to have him on board. You will see a lot of activity with our student ministry, from rafting trips to camping trips to missions trips and personal involvement. You'll see Stu on the campuses of high schools and middle schools interacting with kids. You'll probably see him coaching wrestling, maybe this time at McLaughlin Middle School. He's done it at Hedrick in the past, but that's what I love about Stu. He builds relationships with kids, and so we're excited to have him on board. So Stu, if you want to say anything, keep it short.
Well, I'm excited to be here. So, Grace Point, I am so excited to be a part of this staff and this church. And Jenny and I have missed Medford so much. We want to come home. So thank you for making it possible, Pastor Tom, to come home to be part of this pastoral team, this church. We are so excited. I'm here today because I had a praying mom. I'm here today because I have people that have believed in me all the time. A guy named Carl Ross, who led me to Jesus when I was 17 years old. And I'm coming back because you go where the love is. You go where the support is. And this church, Pastor Tom and the team here, have supported me for many, many years. And I want to be with my brothers and sisters here. And I'm just excited about being part of the team. You live in an incredible place, let me tell you. And that's why I'm coming back, because I want to be a part of this community. I want to get involved. And I'm so excited to begin a new ministry with these kids. You know, our kids today really need love, and they need you involved in their lives, and I just can't wait to bring that and get many of you a part of that. As you see, I'm not 21, and so I'll be recruiting all ages, all right? All ages into our youth program. So.
Amen.
31, right? 31, yeah.
Amen, amen. Wow. Go ahead. We've talked to Stu about the overall family life ministry of the church, and we recognize as a staff, as a leadership, that we've got to reach our younger people before they get to junior high. Right. And so Stu will be working in conjunction with our children's ministry and developing an overall comprehensive family ministry here, and I'm excited about that. Stu will be arriving September 1st as he concludes his ministry up in Poulsbo, Washington with Youth for Christ. His wife, Jenny, will join him in February as she concludes her work up there as well. So we'll be praying for them in the transition and all that will go well. All right, good stuff. Let's pray over this guy. Father, we thank you for Stu. Love this guy. Love his heart. Love his passion for you and for kids. Bless him. Bless him in the transition as he wraps up all the things he needs to wrap up in Poulsbo, and as he begins the journey here and the ministry here in September. We are trusting you for great and wonderful things through his leadership and his vision. Be with Jenny as she wraps things up there as well and concludes her job. We're looking forward to having them both here next February as a team working together, serving you. So in the meantime, we entrust them to you in your care. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Stu. God bless you. While I've got you here as a captive audience, too, many people wonder who my bride is, so I'm going to embarrass her. This is our 46th wedding anniversary today. So, Jane. She has put up with me for 46 years, and that's a true story. So, love you, honey. Congratulations. We've made it 46. Let's go another I don't know, at least 20, right? That would be wonderful. If you have your Bibles, let's open to the book of Galatians, the book of Galatians in our New Testaments. He was raised in the finest of homes, educated in the finest of schools. Early in his life, there was a passion instilled in him for the law of Moses and Judaism. And so he dedicated his life to becoming an ambassador of that law, an ambassador of Judaism. He studied under what was considered to be one of the greatest rabbis of his day. His name was Gamaliel. And the young man that I'm talking about is a man by the name of Saul, raised in the city of Tarsus. And it became Saul's passion to deliver the message of the law into the lives of people, to preserve the message of the law, the sanctity of the law, the honesty and integrity of Judaism as a religion. And so he dedicated his life to that. And when a young upstart movement called Followers of the Way, or Christians, Little Christs, began to take root and take hold in the culture in which he was a part of, and when this movement began to grow, Saul of Tarsus saw it as an enemy to what he believed so deeply in his soul to be true. That this message of salvation through a person named Jesus Christ, by grace through faith, could trump the obedience of the law of Moses was anathema to him. And so he set about on a personal mission, a personal vendetta, to do anything he could to stop the growth of this movement, even so far as persecuting and, if need be, putting to death those who were followers of the way. It was on such a mission one day as he was traveling to Damascus with letters in hand to throw Christians into jail or, need be, put them to death, that he was confronted with the living God. Blinded by a light from heaven, he hears the voice of none other than Jesus Christ himself. And what Jesus says to Saul is this: Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul was at that moment arrested in his mind and in his heart and in his life, and his life would do a 180 from becoming a persecutor of the faith of Christians to becoming the greatest proclaimer of the faith of Christians. After confronting Saul of Tarsus, he would be taken back to Jerusalem, introduced to a couple of apostles, he would be baptized, and immediately God shipped him off to Arabia for 3 years. God knew that there needed to be some reinstruction in the life of this devout Pharisee and to the law of Moses. And so for 3 years, Saul goes through this intensive re-indoctrination, if you will, of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ and how salvation is by grace through faith and faith alone, that the law of Moses could not accomplish what Jesus Christ did. And after that 3-year period of time, he is released by God to begin his ministry as an apostle, one sent forth to proclaim the message of the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ. Paul teams up with another person by the name of Barnabas. Saul was rather short, Barnabas was rather tall. They made a good combination together. They began their ministry in the southern region of Galatia. And they began to minister into 4 distinct communities. Paul would travel to Antioch. From Antioch, he would go to Iconium. From Iconium, he would go to Lystra. From Lystra, he would go to Derbe. And he would proclaim the message of the good news. In Acts chapter 13 and 14, you can read about this first missionary journey. But in Acts 13, verses 38 and 39, this is what we read. "Brothers, listen," this is Paul speaking in Antioch, "we are here to proclaim that through this man Jesus there is forgiveness for your sins. Everyone who believes in him is declared right with God, something the law of Moses could never do." I want you to think about that for a minute. All of his life dedicated to the law of Moses. Now, through the transformation of the gospel, he proclaims that only Jesus could accomplish what the law never could, never was meant to. He goes on teaching in Antioch. If you jump down to verse 44, it says, "The following week, almost the entire city turned out to hear them preach the word of the Lord. But when some of the Jews saw the crowds, they were jealous. So they slandered Paul and argued against whatever he said." He would eventually leave Antioch. The Bible says that he would shake the dust off of his feet as he left. I'll talk a little bit more about that next week. If you've ever been concerned about what other people think about you and you've let that drive your life, we're going to talk about that next week, how you can be set free from what other people think about you. Because honestly, guys, all that matters is an audience of one. And if you're pleasing that one, let other people say what they want. So Paul shakes the dust from his feet. He and Barnabas, they travel over to Iconium. They share there and meet some resistance. In fact, some of these Jews that were antagonistic to Paul and his message follow him from Antioch, about 90 miles, over to Iconium. They harass him there. He leaves Iconium, travels to Lystra. And when he's in Lystra, the Bible says that he is stoned by an angry mob. Acts chapter 14, verse 19. Then some Jews arrived from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowds to their side. They stoned Paul, dragged him out of town, thinking he was dead. But as the believers gathered around him, he got up and went back into the town. The next day he left with Barnabas for Derbe. And I'll tell you, that's guts. Even those who love you and are around you think you're dead, and all of a sudden he pops back up, goes right back into town, starts preaching again. That's who Paul was. And he would eventually make his way to Lystra, to Derbe, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the message that Paul preached was that you are set free from the law. You are set free from religion and the bondage that religion brings. He would travel back through those cities, even though he knew there were people there who didn't like him, who wanted him dead. And he would journey back, wind up back in Jerusalem. And while in Jerusalem, he gets word that some of the believers that had come to faith in Christ, that had been set free from the religion of the law, that had been set free by grace through faith in the message of Jesus, he gets word that some of them have returned to religion, had turned back to their old way of life. And so he writes a letter to these believers in the region of Galatia. And that letter is known to us as the book of Galatians, or the letter to the churches of Galatia. And here's what's interesting. These Christians in this region, in Antioch and Iconium and Lystra and Derbe in particular, these Christians hadn't given up on Jesus. They had just attached a religious system to Jesus. They had added a list of rules and do's and don'ts that had to be followed in order to be saved. They had returned back to the very prison that God had set them free from. The futility of trying to keep the 613 laws of Moses weighed heavy on the lives of everyone. Jesus came to set people free from that, and yet they were going right back into the prison with the other inmates who lived and believed that same way. You know, I have a friend of mine who was a missionary for a time with Youth with a Mission, YWAM, who traveled to remote regions of the world to provide clean water for people to drink. They would drill new wells, go into these remote communities, drill new wells, and put these elaborate filter systems on the wells to make sure that the water for that community, that tribe, would be clean, would be pure. And then they would leave, and typically in about a year, they would go back to check on the wells and to see how things were going. And he would share that a lot of the times he would go back and the people had neglected the wells, they hadn't changed the filters, they had gone back to drinking the old contaminated water that they had had before. And that kind of describes how Paul felt with these churches in Galatia. They had received this fresh, clean, living water of the grace and goodness of God through His Son, Jesus Christ, and they had gone back to this contaminated well of religion, this system of rules and regulations and do's and don'ts. And so Paul writes to them with a great sense of frustration. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, I love the Message paraphrase. He says, Christ has set us free to live a free life. So take your stand. Never again let anyone put a harness of slavery on you. That's kind of the theme for what I want to talk about for the next 3 weeks. Christ has set us free to live free. And so people receive that message, but then we're influenced by others to go back to this prison of the law. And so in Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, Paul writes to them and he says, I am shocked that you are turning away so soon from God, who called you to himself through the loving mercy of Christ. You're following a different way that pretends to be the good news, but is not the good news at all. You are being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ. Those are strong words. Paul says, I'm shocked. I'm shocked after having shared with you the freedom that we have in Jesus that you've gone back to the chains of Judaism, to the chains of the law. And so what does Paul do? He draws a line in the sand between the pure fresh water of Christianity and the contaminated water of the religious system of the law. And here's what Paul wants you and I to know today. He wants us to know that when you attach anything to the gospel of salvation by grace through faith, his words, you are twisting the truth concerning Christ. One translation says, you are perverting the gospel of Christ. That's strong language. Anybody who comes and says it's Jesus plus, anybody who comes and says you have to follow this rule or this law, you're twisting the gospel. You're perverting the gospel of Christ. The people that Paul was specifically talking about in his day and age were a group of people known as Judaizers. It wasn't that they were against Jesus. They just didn't believe he was good enough to save people, so you had to add to Jesus all of these rules and laws that had to be followed in order to be saved. Now, if I understand that correctly, to say that Jesus was not good enough is essentially to say that Jesus was not God. And so you had to add something to him to ensure your salvation. The frustrating thing for those who were listening to this message of the Judaizers is that there were 613 laws that the religious system of the Jews had established. There were 10 given by God, but they had been spread out to over 613 laws, and Paul makes it very clear in his letter to the Galatian believers that those who trust in Jesus for their salvation are free from the law. So if you have your Bibles open to Galatians chapter 3, look at verses 1 through 5. This is what he says. O foolish Galatians, who has cast an evil spell on you? For the meaning of Jesus Christ's death was made as clear to you as if you had seen a picture of his death on the cross. Let me ask you this one question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the law of Moses? Of course not. You received the Spirit because you believed the message you heard about Christ. How foolish can you be? After starting your Christian lives in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort? Have you experienced so much for nothing? Surely it was not in vain, was it? I ask you again, does God give you the Holy Spirit and work miracles among you because you obey the law? Of course not. It is because you believe the message you heard about Christ. Paul makes it very clear, you've been set free from the law. There were three aspects to the law, in case you don't know. There was what was known as the ceremonial law. Those are the things you read about in the Old Testament, the sacrifices that had to be made, the rituals that had to be observed, the offerings that had to be given, the food restrictions that had to be observed, circumcision that had to be a sign of belonging to God if you were a male circumcised on the eighth day. Paul says, all those things are now laid to rest. The law has been set aside. There was also the civil law. What was interesting for the nation of Israel is that it was a theocracy, and so the law of God was also the law of the nation. But what's interesting is Paul makes it very clear in Galatians 3, verses 23 through 26, that when Jesus Christ came, there is now no distinction between Jew and Gentile, male and female, slave or free. What Paul says, we're all one in Jesus Christ. I like it this way. For those of us who are Gentiles, who are now followers of Jesus Christ, we are the new Jews in Jesus. That's how Paul would view us. We're all one tribe. We're all one nation. There's no distinction anymore. And Paul says, so the civil law, that's gone away with. And then there was the moral law. The moral law was the Ten Commandments, ethical standards of behavior, which still should be observed. But Paul would say, following those ethical standards does not save you. Even though it's good to do that, even though those ethical standards are still in place, but they're not the things that save you. Why do I say that? Well, because that's what Paul said, Galatians chapter 2, verse 16. He says, yet we know that a person is made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ, not by obeying the law. And we have believed in Christ Jesus so that we might be made right with God because of our faith in Christ, not because we have obeyed the law. For no one will ever be made right with God by obeying the law. That's pretty clear, huh? Now, when people heard Paul say that, they became very upset. They began to speak against them. They began to slander him. They began to say all manner of things about him. We'll talk about this again next week. But Paul would basically say, I don't care what you say about me. What's important is that I live for the one who has called me. You see, if there's a way to make ourselves right with God by our works, then Jesus wasn't necessary. There was no point for God to send Jesus. The law just would have continued. And so Paul says in Galatians 2:21, I do not treat the grace of God as meaningless, for if keeping the law could make us right with God, then there was no need for Christ to die. So Paul explains that adding all of these religious requirements is a perversion of the true gospel. Anytime someone says it's Jesus plus these rules, it's Jesus plus this list, it's Jesus plus making sure that you do all these things, anytime you do that, you're taking Christianity and you're turning it into a religion. Listen, Christianity is not a religion. Never was intended to be. Christianity is the antithesis of religion, because religion is always about a system of works. Christianity is about a system of grace. In fact, Paul in Galatians chapter 3, if you read through verses 10 through 29, he basically says anyone who preaches a gospel different than salvation by grace through faith is anathema, is cursed, is damned. That's how strong the language is. Grace is greater than religion. Religion literally means to be in bondage. That's what it means. It means to be enslaved. It means to be in a prison cell. And when you attach the word religion to Jesus, you're actually attaching to him the very thing he came to set us free from. Let me give you a simple definition of religion. There's many we could talk about, but here's one for our working for the next 3 weeks. Religion is man's attempt to appease God and earn his favor by working hard and being good enough. I'm just guessing that I'm talking to some of you who maybe were raised in religion. It was about how many times you went to church. When I got saved, I'll just be honest with you, this is why I hate religion so much. I mean, if you didn't go to church on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night, you were second class. If you didn't tithe, you were second class. If you didn't serve in at least two or three ministries, you were second class. It was all about spinning the plates. It was all about doing all these things to let people know how religious you were. It's working hard. It's trying to be good enough. That's what religion is. That's why religion is so exhausting. I'll be honest with you. That's why a lot of people give up on church. Why would I work 40, 50, 60 hours a week and then the church expect me to put in another 40? Here's what Christianity is. Christianity means we are made right with God, not because of what we have done, but because of what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. It's totally different. My salvation is not based upon my human effort. My salvation is based upon God's effort through his Son, Jesus Christ, to bring me salvation. So when we accept Jesus Christ by grace through faith, his righteousness is attached to us. I haven't earned it. I don't deserve it. But it's attached to me. It becomes a part of my resume. His record becomes my record. That's what Christianity is. So if that's true, and it all is, and we'll get into this a little more over the next couple of weeks, here's the million-dollar question. Why then would people go back to religion? Why do people return to religion? Why do you see people trying to spin the plates and earn the approval of God and doing all these things. It's about how I dress, how I look, what I eat, where I go, what I do and what I don't do. All these things, these rules. Well, there's a lot of reasons, perhaps. Let me give you a few. One that I think is a valid reason is that religion offers a method of measurement. A method of measurement. Rules create a balance scale for performance. And so if somebody can give me a list of rules here, hey, this is what Grace Point Fellowship is all about. You know, don't drink, don't dance, don't chew, don't go with girls who do, you know, all these things. You know, check the list. You can check the list. And then if I can check the list, then the scales kind of tip in my favor, right? And I can kind of measure my performance. And if at the end of my life, the scales are tipped in my favor, I get in. I shared with you a few weeks ago that my mom was raised in a denominational background of legalism. Didn't really attend church much, but it was ingrained in her through her family. And she lived with this fear of death because she didn't know if she died, if she was really going to go to heaven, because maybe there's a sin that she committed that she didn't confess. Maybe there's something over here that she was supposed to do that she didn't do. I mean, it's a terrible way to live. It's a heavy burden to bear. Thankfully, the last 5 years of her life, she was set free from that. But I think people return to religion because, well, I can measure myself. It's a system of measurement for me. Secondly, religion gives a feeling of superiority. You know, if I can say that I'm doing all these things and I can look over here and see people that aren't, you know, it kind of puts me above them. So let's go back to Paul. Paul knew the weight of religion when he was a Pharisee. So if you decided to be a Pharisee, it was kind of like a one-upsmanship on being a pastor. You know, there's pastors and there's pastors. Well, a Pharisee was like the cream of the crop of pastors. Think of it that way. They were the ones who really were just incredibly dedicated to the law of Moses, so much so that as a Pharisee, you would add to the 613 laws of Moses and expect people to adhere to those additional laws to prove your superiority. For instance, the law said, honor the Sabbath, okay? That's a good thing. In the New Testament, the Bible says each day is the same as itself. Whatever day you choose as your Sabbath day, just make sure that once a week you have a Sabbath day of rest where you honor God. We choose Sunday, it could be Saturday, it could be Friday, it could be Tuesday, it doesn't matter. So, in addition to honoring the Sabbath, the Pharisees would add another restriction. They would say that you could only walk 7/10 of a mile on the Sabbath. Okay. Well, I'm going to see grandma, and I get to 7/10 of a mile, and her house is another 10th of a mile. No grandma, at least not on the Sabbath. By the way, the laws created creative ways to get around the law, and so people came up with the thought, well, if I put some dirt from my home into my pocket, then technically I've never left my home, right? It just gets insane. You could ride a donkey on the Sabbath, but you couldn't take the saddle off the donkey. You want a good one? If a hen laid an egg on the Sabbath, you couldn't eat the egg from the hen on the Sabbath or even the next day. Why? Because the hen had to work to produce the egg on the Sabbath. Anybody here want to go back to the law? You see, that's why Paul says you've been set free, so live free from that kind of stuff. Listen, when someone feels like they have to write new laws to help God out, that's a red flag. If a church says, well, we're going to add some rules, some laws, they're really not in the Bible, but they're common sense things we're going to expect you to do. When somebody says that to you, run. Run. The Bible says, let no unwholesome word come out of your mouth. That's a great admonition. That's something we should all follow. That's a good thing until someone starts to define for you what your good words are and aren't. So I'm fresh out of Bible college. And my first ministry is in Atascadero, California. And I preach my first sermon. So picture this. First sermon preached, And I'm standing at the door greeting people as they're leaving. I don't know who they are. They don't know me. And this woman, at least I think she was, comes up to me. First words out of her mouth. It wasn't, "Hi, Tom, good to have you. We're glad you're here." First words were, "I don't appreciate your use of words." I thought the sermon was so good, I wanted to take notes on it. I said, "Excuse me?" She goes, "I don't appreciate your use of words." And I said, "Well, what do you mean by that?" She goes, "Well, you used euphemisms in your sermon." Now, I graduated with a degree in biblical literature, bachelor's in biblical literature. I didn't graduate with a bachelor's in English literature. I didn't know what a euphemism was. So, dumb me, I said, "Well, what's a euphemism?" She goes, "You said darn in your sermon. You might as well have said damn." Honest truth, I said, "Well, shoot, I didn't mean that." I mean, I got 2 feet in the grave now. I'm done. 2 years later, I'm looking in the rearview mirror of that church because that wasn't a good fit for me. You follow what I'm saying? "Let no unwholesome word come out of my mouth." Yeah, I get that, but don't tell me what that is for me. The Bible says, guard your heart. We talked about that last week if you were here. And you might take notice that with intentionality, I didn't give you specifics of how to do that because I can't. You're supposed to work out your salvation with God. Now, there are obviously direct commands of God that we are to follow, but so much of the Christian life is lived in the realm of the gray where we have to figure it out for ourselves. And so, guard your heart. That's good until someone starts to define what that means for you. Not just for them, it'd be good for them, but now it's got to be good for you too. In other words, you guard your heart, you better not go to any movies. You guard your heart, you better not have any cable TV in your home. You guard your heart, you better not listen to secular music. You guard your heart, no dancing. You guard your heart, no card playing. Now listen, those all may be good rules for someone to follow, but when you attach them to Jesus as rules for everyone else to follow, here's what happens. People feel burdened, or people just get tired of trying to keep the rules and quit altogether. That's not what God intended for his people. Again, we have to work out our salvation. Now, if you're a gambling addict, playing cards for you may not be a good thing, but I can't legislate that for you. You have to work that out. Does that make sense? The Bible says, don't get drunk with wine. Well, that's a good thing. Nobody should get drunk. But someone comes along and says, well, you can't drink at all. Well, the Bible doesn't say that. I'm not advocating that you go out and drink, but I'm saying the Bible doesn't say that you're going to be condemned if you do. The Bible says don't be drunk. And yet rules and rules and rules are written for God. And people attach themselves to the rules because they figure, well, if I can just keep the rules, then I'm good, I'm in. Jesus spoke against this very thing often. There's one particular story in Luke chapter 11 where Jesus is invited to eat in a Pharisee's home. So one of these religious leaders is curious about Jesus and invites him over for dinner. And Jesus accepts the invitation and Jesus sits down to eat and the Pharisee notices that Jesus doesn't wash his hands first before he eats. And so Jesus sits down and he starts passing food around. And the Pharisee says, hey, the law of Moses says you're supposed to wash your hands. This is so cool. Jesus says, I never said that. I wrote the law of Moses. I never said that. You said that. So what's Jesus doing? You know what he's doing? He's picking a fight with this guy. Jesus is going to draw a line. And so Jesus holds him to account and says, look, you're asking me to do something God didn't ask me to do. This is your man-made rule. And then he lays into him. Luke chapter 11. You Pharisees are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you're filthy, full of greed and wickedness. Fools! Didn't God make the inside as well as the outside? So clean the inside by giving gifts to the poor, and you'll be clean all over. He goes on in just a scathing denunciation of their hypocrisy. Rules, law, religion. Jesus says, no, I came to abolish all of that. I've came to set you free so that you can live free. Finally, people go back to religion because religion provides a false sense of comfort. If I know that I'm spinning the right plates and I know that I'm observing the right rules, then I can feel good. You know, when I went to Bible college in Joplin, Missouri, there was a blue law in the state of Missouri. Anybody familiar with the blue law? Blue law in the state of Missouri basically said that on Sundays you could not buy food except for basic staples like eggs and bread and milk, which I thought was interesting. If you're going to create a law, make it a law, you're already giving an exemption to the law. It's wrong to buy food, but it's okay to buy this kind of food. It didn't make sense to me, but the thought was by not buying food on Sunday, there was a comfort you had in knowing that you were honoring God. Well, God never said you couldn't buy food on Sunday. Professors at the college I went to would teach us that it was sinful for us to eat out at a restaurant on Sundays because it caused somebody else to have to work on Sundays. I'm just telling you straight up, nobody was going to keep me from Chicken Mary's on Sunday afternoon. It just wasn't going to happen. At the Bible college I went to, the men could wear jeans. I could dress like this and go to class, but you were not allowed to have facial hair. You were not allowed to have sideburns that went below your ear. Short hair. A sister college, same denomination of churches, a sister college in Illinois was just the opposite. Men had to wear slacks, shirt, and tie to class, but they could have facial hair. Same group of churches. Different laws. Crazy. I decided to push the rule on facial hair. I had one class left to take. It was a night class. And if you know anything about me, I just don't like legalism. I hate it. And so I'm going to push the limit on this. So I grew a beard. And I go to class. Every evening that I had class for the last semester of the school, and my professor never said anything. Isn't that amazing? But yet it was a rule. It was the law. God has set us free. So live free. Do you remember back in the 80s reading about the Chicago Tylenol murders? You remember that? Any of you old enough to remember that? What happened was somebody, you know, went into a store and opened some Tylenol bottles and put some poison in the Tylenol bottles, and the people who grabbed those bottles, seven people were murdered as a result of that, which created the new packaging standards that we have now. That's why you can't open your arthritis medication when you desperately need it, because... So I was thinking about that, and I close with this analogy to what I think God is trying to say to us. Isn't it interesting that something that was meant to bring health and healing and comfort and freedom from pain became a poison that brought death? And in the same way, Jesus, who came to bring healing and comfort, freedom from our guilt and our shame, freedom from the need to perform, freedom from the need to spin the plates, freedom from the need to be good enough. Becomes a poison by religion. Religion is like a poison that is added to Christianity, that only brings death, that only brings defeat. So like Paul, I would say to anyone caught in the throes of religion, I'm astonished, I'm amazed. Why would you go back into the prison cell of religion when you've been set free to live in the grace and the mercy and the goodness of God? Our commitment to you as a leadership in this church is to preach grace. Our commitment to you is to help you on your journey, to find where God wants you to be on your journey. Our commitment to you is to love you no matter where you are on your journey, to help you get to where God wants you to be. That's Christianity. You will not find from us a list of rules and regulations, the expectation for you to dot certain I's and cross certain T's. You will not find that here. Now here's the deal. God gave to each of us freedom, knowing fully well what we might do with it. My encouragement is that we use his freedom to grow ourselves and to glorify him. And if we'll do that, the truth will have truly set us free. Amen? Let's stand together this morning. Father, I pray your richest blessing on us as a people of God. May we not abuse your freedom, but just rejoice in it. Thank you that you have came to set us free from the bondage of religion, of legalism, of rules, of regulations. Help us to be students of your word, to follow your heart, your truth. Lead us on the journey you have for us, ever closer to you, more inspired by you with each passing day. Bless us now this week to so live for you, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you need freedom, save it. He's a prison-shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain-breaker.